I'm not going to be filming the back of my head, right? Because I don't want to be the one that...
No, I tested it. Get out of your way and just
do more games.
No, I'm good.
We make these jokes.
He's like, this is not time for jokes.
No, it's not. Darling.
Hello, folks. Welcome to American Preparatory Academy West Valley's production of The Drowsy Chaperone. My name is David DeAgostini. It's funny because I tell all my actors to find your light, and I realized I had stepped out. So, thank you so much for coming this evening. You guys are amazing. I have to imagine every single person here is somehow connected to a cast member, right? We don't do million-dollar advertisements in the newspaper, so you either have friends, family, students, whoever, who are in the show tonight. Thank you so much for supporting me. One of the things we teach at APA in theater is this idea that theater is performing arts are a way for us to give a gift. I have an invitation for you. These students have worked very hard for the last couple of months to prepare a pretty awesome gift for you guys. But my experience is that gifts are no good if they're not received. And I invite you to receive this gift by taking out your phones, turning them off so they don't interfere, but even more importantly, resisting the temptation. And I have this temptation too. My daughter did ballet for many, many years. I wanted to catch every little moment. But I invite you, put your phones away and be present with these students. Don't worry about capturing this moment for posterity. Live theater is an amazing thing. There might be many of you who have never seen a live theatrical production. Maybe you're used to TV or movies. And yeah, that's all about film. It's all about having the moment forever. Live theater is something different. It's ephemeral. It happens and then it goes away, but there's a beauty in that moment. And I invite you to be present with these students, to receive that gift they're giving. And my promise is that you'll have a really amazing experience. A couple of notes. Please make sure you keep feet and elbows out of the aisle. This aisle is a little skinnier than we've had in years past, and we do have a couple of entrances from here, just for safety. No photography, also for safety. I blind these students enough with the lights in their eyes. We don't want to do that with flashing. Again, thank you so much for supporting this production. And I will hand it over to our students to take it.
do when I'm sitting in a darkened theater waiting for the show to begin. I pray. Oh, dear God, please let it be a good show. And let it be short, oh Lord of Heaven, please. 2 hours is fine. 3 hours is too much. Oh, and keep the actors out of the audience, goodness. I did not pay a good $10 to have the fourth wall come crashing down around my ears. I just want a story and a few good songs to take me away. I just want to be entertained. I mean, isn't that the point? Amen. You know, there was a time when people sat in darkened theaters and thought to themselves, what have George and Ira Gershwin got for us tonight? Or can Cole Porter pull it off again? Can you imagine? Now it's just, please, Elton John, must we continue this charade? It used to be, sitting there in the dark, you knew that when the show came up, you would be transported to another world, a world full of color and music and glamour. And you thought to yourself, when are the lights gonna come up? Oh, how things have changed. Hi. How are we today?
Good.
That's good. I'm feeling a little blue myself. You know, a little anxious for no particular reason. A little sad I should be feeling anxious at this age. You know, a little subconscious anxiety resulting in a non-specific sadness. A state that I call blue. Anyway, whenever I'm feeling this way, blue, I like to listen to my music. So, I was going through my records this morning. Yes, records. And I was about to put on the soundtrack recording of Meredith Wilson's The Music Man. I had a craving for a young Ronnie Howard. But then I said, no, let's have a treat. Let's disappear for a while into the decadent world of the 1920s, when the champagne flowed while the caviar chilled and all the world was a party! For the wealthy, anyway. So, I dug about, and what did I find? But one of my favorite shows, Gable and Stein's The Jousy Chaperone. Remember? Music by Julie Gable, lyrics by Sidney Stein. It's a two-record set remastered from the original recording made in 1928. It's a full show with the original cast, including Beatrice Stockwell. Isn't she amazing? Look at it. Can you believe it? Let me read to you what it says on the back. It says, mix-ups, mayhem, and a gay wedding. Well, of course the phrase gay wedding has a different meaning now. But back then, it just meant fun. And that's just what this show is. Fun. So, would you indulge me? Would you let me play the record for you now?
Yes.
I was hoping you would say yes. Sorry, it takes a little quiet. You hear that sound? I love that sound. To me, that's the sound of a time machine starting up. All right, now let's visualize. Imagine if you will, it's November 1928. You've just arrived at the doors of the Marosco Theater in New York. It's very cold outside. Remember when it used to be cold in November? Not anymore. November's the new August now, it's global warming, and we're all doomed! Anyways, it's very cold outside. You don't care because you're going to see a Broadway show. Sounds like a dance tune. Kind of.
It's a miracle, madam.
My dress, my fancy dress. I don't know why I'm wearing it, must confess. My dress, I love my dress. Would someone tell me why I put it on?
Yes, your dress, your fancy dress. 'Twas such a pleasure airing it, restitching it, preparing it, God bless. Your dress is one fine dress, and I will tell you why you put it on. Wedding bells will ring, wedding bells will chime. Madam, you're the hostess, and it's happy wedding time. Wedding bells will ding, wedding bells will call. Wedding bells will ding, and here we will ding along. Your dress, your fancy dress. We're very, very glad you put it on. Wedding guests have come, wedding guests are here, wedding guests are back.
Oh, thank you all for coming. I tell you, I must be some lucky fellow. Who would have thought that I, Robert Barton, would be marrying a glamorous showgirl, and that glamorous showgirl would be willing to drop a successful career to marry me, Robert Barton. Now, if it weren't for Prohibition, I'd say let's raise a glass.
Hear, hear.
To Miss Janet Vandegraaff, the most beautiful girl in the world.
Absolutely not.
Excuse me?
The groom mustn't see his bride on the day of the wedding. It's bad luck.
I hope you heard that, because that's the plot. Basically, hang on for the ride.
Oh. Breakfast will be served in the Arabian room.
Say, it's a little early today to be drinking, isn't it?
I don't understand the question.
Look, you just gotta keep Jen away from Robert. You're the chaperone. That's your only job.
I won't come.
Oh, Robert, who's my little monkey?
I am your little monkey!
So, with the bride and the groom whisked away, we turn our attention to the beat plot, which involves the producer. Mr. Bouncy!
Getting married and leaving show business?
Mr. Bouncy!
Doesn't she know I've got obligations?
Mr. Bouncy! I can be a leading lady. You said it yourself, I'm useless in the chorus.
Kitty, I've already told you, you ain't got what it takes.
But I've been taking lessons. Singing, acting, and ballet.
Ballet?
Yeah, and I'm pretty good too. Last week I trained for Swanee Lake. A little annotation. Kitty and Celtic were a couple in real life. Jack and Sadie Adler. Now, this is a familiar comic construct. A stupid woman and her long-suffering companion. Look, she appears stupid, but in the end she does something quite clever and makes everyone wonder whether it was all just an act. The irony here is that Sadie actually was quite stupid. Jack had to explain all the jokes to her, apparently, but still, she had a wonderful career on the stage. At the time, the theater was the only place where stupid people can earn a decent living. This was before television, of course.
Giddy, I don't got time for this.
A petite four, Mr. Feltic.
Not now.
Have some nice peripheral.
Boys, I'm not hungry.
Then perhaps we could give you something else to chew on.
Yeah, something ain't food.
What?
Your confusion is to be expected, although we stand here before you in the guise of innocent pastry chefs. We are also, and primarily, employees of a certain individual.
A certain individual?
A certain individual. Who happens to be the largest single investment in Celtic's Follies. He sent us here,
as pastry chefs,
to express his concern about Miss Vandegraaff's impending nuptials.
Specifically,
that if she gets married and leaves the show,
then there ain't no show.
Say, don't I know you?
No, you don't.
Have you ever spent any time in a coma?
No. But I have a cousin in Seattle.
Okay, boys, you tell your boss this wedding's not gonna happen. Take my word.
I will take your word, all right. But to go back on that word would be a recipe for disaster. Now we hope we have married ourselves perfectly. Eclair, one. Cannoli, hope.
You must gotta be kidding me.
A trifle blood, so tired with me.
Okay, you dropped the pastry chef routine.
Alas. We ganache.
We're on the lamb.
Lamb's an entree, macaroon.
The gangsters were played by interchangeable vaudeville duo, the Tall Brothers, John and Peter Tall. They were born Abraham and Mendel Moskowitz, but were renamed at Ellis Island by some sarcastic immigration official. They were an early example of the typical Broadway gangster, full of wordplay and stylized movements. Not very intimidating, unless you find dancers intimidating, in which case you're really weird.
Well, leave the mat in your hands, Mr. Felty. In the meantime, feel free to browse a dessert carousel.
Try the Toledo surprise.
It's to die for!
Holy cats! Mr. Felty, they're gangsters!
Very perceptive. Now go out of your face. I've got to stop this wedding, but how? Oh, Lord in heaven, how? How?
I always thought this moment was a little overplayed. So, with the story well on its way, let's move to the groom's room.
Hey there, handsome. Show me those pearly whites.
The groom was played by the dashing Percy Hyman. He started out as an upright toothpaste man. His fabulous smile adorned every tooth. Upright was hugely popular in the early 20s because it contained cocaine. It's true. If you look at the label, it was the fifth ingredient down right after sugar. Anyway, it wasn't very long before he became a huge matinee idol.
Now don't you worry. It's perfectly normal for a groom to be nervous on his wedding day. It is, Of course!
Now, some people say he was a terrible actor, but to those people I say,
shut up!
Hey there, Mr. Mirror Man. Shake him and a boy man. Trembling like them fraidy cats do. Something make me bothering. You know, shoot up. Cold feet, cold feet. Brother, you got cold feet. You can make them cold feet hot. Make the little red and dumb feet. Hot feet can be uncontrolled. Really make them cold feet drop down the aisle.
Years have taken their toll on him would be a grotesque understatement.
They wheeled him out, and he had that wide-eyed expression of pain confusion that God reserves for the very, very old on their birthdays. You know what I'm talking about. The one who says, "Who are you? Who am I? And why is this cake on fire?" You get what I mean. Anyway.
All right, that's enough dancing like fools.
Sorry, George, I was just trying to calm my nerves. It is my wedding day, after all.
Well, you could have snapped an ankle. Tap dancing is too dangerous. Why don't you go for a skate instead? That's what I like to do on our water blossom steam.
George, what would I do with that?
Oh, no, wasn't. Oh, no, you are not going to like that, my friend. You might see Janet. Here, put on this blindfold.
Oh, George, you think of everything.
Just looking out for you, my boy. And no more tap dancing.
Yeah.
Miss Van de Graaff has no desire to continue a life on the stage. Can't you see it's killing her soul?
Don't worry, boys. This isn't over yet.
Yeah, I'm surprised you didn't do an encore.
Discreet.
Yes, ma'am.
It is prohibition after all.
I'm aware of that, ma'am.
We'll have to use code words.
write it down.
I understand, madam. A glass of ice water is a glass of vodka.
What's a glass of ice water?
Vodka.
Ice water?
Vodka.
Ice?
Vodka.
Ah, you see? It's settled then. One less thing to do. Underling, might I please have a glass of ice water? I found our meeting with the pastry chefs rather trying, and I would enjoy a glass of refreshing ice water.
Your ice water, madam.
Get your vodka, you poop!
I hate this scene.
Now I do need a glass of ice water.
A glass of ice water, madam?
Yes, ice water. Are you going deaf?
What that I were.
You can see where this is going, can't you? It's really just a series of spit takes.
Your ice water, madam.
Get your vodka, you poop!
You know, in some ways, the drowsy chaperone was quite progressive.
Your ice water, madam.
That was your vodka, you poop!
Yes, it was quite progressive. Other times, things like this were still in 1928. Anyway, I'm just going to skip ahead.
Ooh. Oh, really? That's not necessary. I suppose I'm just looking for it's a dismal little world in which we live. It can bore you till you've nothing left to give. Seven overrated wonders, seven underwhelming seas, six excruciating continents, Antarctica. Oh, please. Still, you mustn't let it lick your splendid hope so bland. Keep your eyeball on the highball in your hand. As we stumble along, across the life's crowded dance floor, as we push and we shove, we live and we learn. And when we finally leave the bar,
of the poodles.
conscience while you're listening to this part.
I am a dad. And you are bad.
No, I am not.
What? But this is bad also. And you are the only one here. Therefore, you must be bad.
Interesting argument. But I'm afraid you are a moron.
What?
Me? No, Brian. Perhaps I could take a message.
Yes, yes, very good. Dear Van de Graaff Bride, I must see you and make all your dreams come true. The sooner is better. Signed, Adalfo, the King of Roma.
Well, you saw through my little ruse. You found me out.
Ah, so you are the bride.
Apparently, yes. Take me, Adalphes.
What? No, no, no. Not Adalphes. Adalfo. You must remember my name, or it was for everything. How can I make you remember?
Oui.
I hear she's very beautiful.
Oui.
and glamorous.
Ah, oui, oui.
Is it true that she has an exceptionally broad range and excels at playing both comedic and dramatic roles?
Say, I'm having trouble placing your accent. What part of France are you from?
The middle parts. Where they make the toast. You were telling me about how do you say it in English, fiancé?
That's right.
Well, tell me, when was the moment that you knew she was the only one for you?
It's a funny story, actually. We were standing on the leader deck of the Ile de France.
Yes.
I was amusing her with stories of my father's oil interests.
And then what happened?
I looked into her eyes, her big, glamorous eyes, and I felt all woozy.
And then you fell. And then you fell?
Yes, right on my keister. And I said, well, I guess I don't have my sea legs yet.
But we haven't left the dock.
That's what she said. And that's what I knew it must be like.
And then you said?
And then I said, there was a time I could stop on a dime. Forbearance was one of my talents. But since you've been around, I can't hold my ground. I'm consistently losing my balance.
Mr. Feldzeek,
according to schedule.
Now it's time we received your just desserts. What do you say, partner? Should we whip up something special for Mr. Feltic?
Yeah. How about a Toledo surprise?
And it's by our choice.
A Toledo surprise? I've never heard of that.
No! You haven't! Those people who have heard of it are generally never heard from again.
We'll share the recipe with you.
First, you chop the nuts.
Then you pound the dough.
Then you bake it up nice and slow. And then you got your Toledo. Toledo surprise!
Can you run that by me again?
It's a very simple recipe, Mr. Feltsy.
First, you chop the nuts.
Then you pound the dough.
Then you bake it up nice and slow. And then you got your Toledo. Toledo surprise! Say, why don't we give them a little taste?
All right.
Hold it! What style, what grace, what rhythm! Open your fists. Now, shake them. Now, give me that recipe one more time. Da 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 da. Go!
Chop the nuts, pound the dough, bake it up nice and slow. Then you got a Toledo. Toledo surprise!
Right, sell it!
Hit the peach, peel the skin, mush it up, throw it in. That's a tasty Toledo. Toledo surprise!
Thank you.
yes. Yes, but the tune is so infectious.
Oh, Robert, this is the saddest day of my life.
Almost there.